From the mid-1940s through the following decades, the atomic age was fully upon the United States. From nuclear weapons developed and used during World War II through the Cold War, the federal government encouraged domestic mining of uranium ore by guaranteeing a price and becoming the sole purchaser of uranium during that period. Prior to this time, most of its uranium had been sourced from Germany and former Czechoslovakia. But from the 40s until the 70s, privately owned mines popped up in the Four Corners region of the Southwest, New Mexico, Arizona, Utah, and Colorado. More than 1,000 of these mines are believed to exist on Navajo Nation. Uranium was first discovered near Cove, Arizona, and then in more locations within the reservation. Because of the mines' proximity to their communities, and because often there were limited jobs in the area, many Navajo men and women started working as blasters, muckers, transporters, technicians, and on-surface jobs. Those who lived further away moved with their families and lived in mine camps near the site. According to interviews, the workers and their families were glad to have the opportunity near home. Although the work was difficult, and Navajo men were responsible for the most challenging and dangerous parts of the job, it wasn't obvious to them just how dangerous it was. Some of the negative health effects of uranium mining were known at the time, as studies had been conducted on European mine workers, which revealed risks of lung cancer from radon exposure as early as the 1870s. Clear links were also drawn between mine work and silicosis, tuberculosis, pneumonia, and emphysema. Navajo workers were not informed about the long-term consequences of working and living around uranium ore and waste. They had no idea that the material they were pulling out of the ground could be damaging to their health. In interviews, miners report a total lack of knowledge of these risks, and they frequently had to work without any safety equipment. Little information was provided to miners in general, but Navajo workers were especially in the dark, because educational material, infrequent as it was provided only in English, with no translation. Beyond working in the mines day-to-day, uranium became a dangerous presence in many other parts of the Navajo family's lives. Because many families had relocated, they often lived in homes built near the mines. Waste from mining was plentiful, so piles of stone and dust were left standing near the worker camps, and radioactive material was swept up and carried in the wind. Tailings, which are the sludge piles left over from the process of separating the uranium from raw ore, were on the surface, and children would often play in them or on the piles of rock nearby. Water and livestock were contaminated from runoff, and sometimes the homes themselves were built out of mine waste materials. Families lived for months or decades with radioactive walls, floors, and even ovens and fireplaces. In the 50s, a study was conducted by the U.S. Public Health Service, which attempted to confirm the link between mine work and cancer demonstrated by the European studies. This study measured the amount of radon in southwestern mines and health effects of their workers. But even while the Health Service was investigating, they didn't disclose why the study was taking place, which violated guidelines of informed consent and left vulnerable people in the dark. Of course, this study was able to confirm the negative health effects, but this information was prevented from reaching the public for some time. After the Health Service's study, some scientists and officials, including Duncan Holliday, the engineering director of the study, started recommending the use of ventilation systems in the mines, which could cycle fresh air in and radon out by using a system of vents and blowers. Holliday firmly argued before the federal government for these changes, but unfortunately, even with evidence, even though the government initiated the uranium boom, he and other scientists and engineers were unable to convince officials to take action, and they were prevented from speaking publicly about their findings. By 1958, only one state, New Mexico, had enacted policies about safe working radon levels. However, these rules weren't enforced reliably. Early in the 1960s, Navajo communities started to investigate the reason for what seemed like high rates of respiratory illness in their families. A group of widows started holding meetings at the Red Valley Chapter House, where they shared their stories, grieved, and strategized. They believed it was the mine's fault for knowingly exposing them to hazards, and the government's fault for doing nothing about it. The families contacted the Red Rock Tribal Council delegate, and together they were able to organize a meeting with Stuart Udall, who was the Interior Secretary at the time. After their meeting, they were invited to D.C. to speak, and in 1979, funded by community donations and bake sales, the widows traveled to D.C. and testified before Congress. Their testimonies were moving, but it took another decade to see real change. In 1990, 50 years after the start of the uranium boom, Congress compensated the families with the passing of the Radiation Exposure Compensation Act. It outlined eligibility criteria and lump sums for mining, milling, and transporter workers. Affected families would need to provide adequate documentation of employment at a mine for a period of time, then evidence of a particular disease. In addition, RECA allowed for compensation of test site workers and those living in counties downwind of nuclear test sites. By 2018, nearly 35,000 claims had been approved, with a payout of over $2 billion. Today, 86% of the uranium used by the U.S. is imported, and the boom is over. The government program Superfund provides technical and financial assistance to help with cleanup of closed mine sites. In 2014, the EPA, in coordination with Navajo Nation, started the first round of cleanup, which included contaminated mine sites, homes, and water sources. In 2020, a new 10-year plan was drafted, which builds upon previous cleanup work, including 230 additional mine sites, groundwater and drinking water remediation and monitoring, additional radiological assessment of structures, and coordination with Navajo Nation to give them a greater say by incorporating Diné fundamental law into the EPA and Superfund process going forward. In recent years, there has been a renewed interest in uranium mining in the U.S., and the discussion about safety and the potential for new contamination of native land and resources is ongoing.